What's up, Bear Nation? I'm Bear with BearIndependent.com. You know that. Got a question. Somebody wrote in to the website and asked my opinion on something. And I figured I'd answer it here on YouTube because it illustrates some of the broader concepts of what we talk about here at this channel. Re-preparedness, bug out, resilience, and resistance. And I want to kind of unpack those concepts in answering this question. That being said, typically the way this works, if you send an email to BearIndependent.com, ask a question and expect an answer, not likely to happen. That is our MO, our modus operandi at Patreon. That's what we do at Patreon. So you guys know the drill. It's $5 a month. There's a description or a link in the description of every video and live stream. But I thought that this was a good question, so I'll read you the question while redacting some of the names and some of the details, and then we'll unpack my answer. Hello, love your channel. We live in Beersheba, Israel, which is a city of about 230,000 and is in the desert. That is approximately due southeast of Gaza and due southwest of Hebron. Hebron being one of my favorite places in the Bible, in the land. That's where Caleb set up shop. You know, Caleb, son of Jephunneh, one of the two spies that gave a good report in the land. And after, at 85 years old, after the land was taken by force, 5 years of open warfare in the promised land, Caleb says to Joshua, "Hey, bro, I want that mountain." And Joshua, paraphrasing, New Living Bear Translation, says, "Bro, you're old as dirt, and there's giants that live up there." Caleb says, "I'm as good to go now as the day I was when Moshe tapped us on the shoulder to go spy out the land." And Joshua says, "Hey, if you can take it, you can have it." And Caleb says, "Boys, grab your swords. We're going to work." And they go up that mountain, and they kill not one, not two, three giants in the promised land. And I love the parable of that. Now, that Caleb actually did that, but I love the idea that just because you're in the promised land doesn't mean there aren't still giants that need to be slain. So fan of Hebron, for sure. So these people live in Beersheba, a city of about 230,000, and it's in the desert. My husband and I are prepping hard. He's 71, I'm 66. So older folks. We have a marvelous, supportive community of younger folks, but they are completely oblivious to the coming catastrophe. In our neck of the woods, we will definitely be impacted by the war between Russia and Ukraine. We also live under the threat of attack from Iran. Then there's the periodic bombing by the Palestinians. On top of all that, there's the usual global pandemic and economic stuff. My husband is a family physician, and I am a clinical psychologist. What should we be preparing? What should we be thinking about? Thanks. And then, of course, they give their contact information, which I'm not going to share with you. All right. So you live in a city of 230,000 people. We'll just round up 250,000 because I'm sure there's undocumented people there as well. So you live in a city of 250,000 people. The reasoning for that is likely because you're white-collar professionals, and that's where your economic basis. That's where you can do the work that you do. The first thing I would do is figure out where are you going to retreat to, because you have a population density issue. Another piece of land outside of the city, wherever it may be, however it may be, because sooner or later it may become untenable for you to stay in Beersheba or Dallas or the suburbs of Illinois, or you know, Westchester County, New York, or LA, or whatever, right? So you need a redoubt, a retreat, a place that you can go to where the population density doesn't suck. There are many reasons why one would bug out. It could be the Iranians, or the Palestinians, or the Russians, or the Ukrainians, or NATO. But it could also be localized natural disaster. We see that a lot with the work that we do at Grindstone Ministries. It could be a lack of water in the city, or services, or civil unrest due to the pandemic and supply chain issues, which you brought up in your email. So there's lots of reasons why the cities could become untenable. And so you need to have a place that you can bug out to if they become untenable. Now, with that, fully acknowledging that developing a retreat is a lot of work. It's a massive use of resources, blood, sweat, tears, time, and treasure. It takes a lot of work, it takes a lot of money, it takes a lot of effort to build a retreat, or at least just have a piece of land that's suitable to go camping on. A lot of effort. And then there's some infrastructure that's required when you're there. I'd say living in the desert, primary thing I'd be concerned about is water, because you can bring food with you. You can even grow food in the desert. There are means and methods which you should research in order to be able to grow food in the desert, because we want to shift our mindset from consumer to producer. Because on a long enough timeline, I believe that our ability to produce food is going to be foundational to our ability to survive. So I'd get a well in for sure. If you have a group of people around you who are supportive but oblivious, that's going to require a good bit of evangelizing on your part, which we'll come to in a moment. But this retreat, you need to have a way to get there, which means hopefully primarily a vehicle that can carry all of the stuff that you're going to need to bring there. Potentially, if you can, after you develop the retreat, you should, if you can, stockpile as much of your stuff there as possible. So that's fewer trips, fewer stuff you have to shove into the station wagon to get from where you are to where you want to be, right? Understanding that all systems ultimately degrade into a man-portable system, meaning that you need to be able to carry the bare necessities on your back. That comes back to bug-out bag. Bug-out bag is based upon what is the mission. Not what I would like to have, not what the Green Beret threw in his bag on the YouTube video. What do I need to have to support the mission? And the mission is not frolicking through the woods or the desert in this case for a number of days, making my little coffee and making fuzz sticks with my bushcraft knife. And no, it's get from where it's bad to where it's not bad and or good. Okay, that's the mission. Move is the mission. So being older, your bags are going to need to be lighter. If your husband is a family physician, you guys should understand something about physical capabilities, how the human body works, and you need to train your body, even if it's an hour a day, 5 days a week, to carry that bag. Go for walks with your backpack on so that you have the ability to move. Also, have your vehicle topped off, ready to go, in good condition, good running, operating condition, squared away. And then you need multiple routes to and from there. And once you constitute a retreat, long-term planning, you need another one. Whether that's another piece of property that you own or friends in a different part of the area that you can go to or whatever. Because once you occupy the retreat, it's no longer your retreat. It's no longer your bug-out location. You may have to leave from there as well if it becomes untenable from there. So this gets into planning. Operational planning is a huge part of how to conduct a successful operation, a successful mission. And it's one of the things that the prepper community, frankly, is terrible at. So you need to apply as much operational planning to this as possible and then execute on that so that you have a place to go that's outside of the city. I have a feeling this video is going to go long. Feature length, as they call it. On this channel, we have a playlist called The Prepper Classroom. The Prepper Classroom is a whiteboard series. It's free here on YouTube, where we delve into dozens of topics in a classroom setting, breaking stuff down Barney style as to what you need to know, what to focus on, what to avoid, for bug out bags, for mission planning, for water procurement and storage, for food production, food storage, all the commo, intel, security, all the prepper stuff, convoy ops and vehicle operations. It's all there in the Prepper Classroom. Go watch that for a deeper dive on any one subject. And I would recommend at this point, given the questions that you're asking, you need to watch the whole thing, watch the whole series, get you a notebook and take notes and make action items in those notes so that you can execute on what you need to do. As far as a marvelous and supportive community of younger folks that are completely oblivious to the coming catastrophe, This is your opportunity to evangelize. I believe firmly in what I call the four quarters philosophy. I would rather have four quarters than 100 pennies in my pocket. They're worth the same amount, but it's much easier to deal with four quarters. Those four individuals have a much higher value than the 100 1 cent or 1 penny individuals. And I don't know, maybe you're on the shekel over there, but my point is, four individuals of greater value are more important to me. I assign a higher value to quarters than I do to pennies. They're more valuable than 100 individuals of low value. I don't even pick pennies up off the ground. I'm not a fan of pennies. They don't make it into my change jar, right? If it's not a nickel, a dime, or a quarter, I'm not interested in it. And so if you have a large group of supportive people, that's wonderful. Who are the key individuals within that group that you should be evangelizing to that could essentially be cadre or subordinate leadership as you grow this network, which you will need to do? So identify those people and start evangelizing to them. Why is this important? Explain the threats to them and then offer solutions to those threats to them. Here's how we can withstand the coming unpleasantness. This is what I suggest that we do. Now, what do you think? How are we going to put this plan together? Because if you get them to help you in the planning, now they have buy-in to execute. If you tell them what to do, very often you're not going to get that buy-in that's necessary for them to actually do it. And so you have to make your plan our plan so that we can execute on it. So I would identify, again, key individuals within this community that you have. Three or four people. Bring them into the fold, evangelize them, get them on board. They become your cadre. They become your subordinate leadership. And now, if each person, right, you start with you and your husband, your one family unit. You get four more people or families on board. Okay, so that's five, right? Now, if each family gets another 3 to 5 on, that's 15 to 25 exponential growth, okay? So you need to evangelize and explain why. Ask them to watch this channel. Ask them to watch Southern Prepper 1 or Viking Preparedness or S2 Underground or Forward Observer, Gray Zone Warlord, right? There's lots of information out there that's actionable. That's what you need to focus on, not the 15 reasons that the zombies are going to rape your dog and eat your kids videos, not the fear porn and the doom mongering, the actionable stuff. Get them on board. So we talked about bug out and squaring out a bug out location and having multiple locations, multiple nodes, spider points, places that you can go to, because once you occupy your bug out location, it's no longer your bug out location. It's now your retreat. And what happens if it becomes untenable? The next is resilience. Resilience essentially is stockpiling goods and training up the skill set that you will need to employ those goods, right? Tool set, skill set, mindset. Sounds like you have the mindset already. So you need the skill set and the tool set. The tool set is the stuff. The skill set is your mind and your heart and your hands, your ability to do it with automaticity to not have to think about it, okay? So if your husband is a family physician, I would start with, because many people ask the question, well, what can I bring to the table? Your husband's a doctor. You're a psychologist. You have skills that will be applicable to the coming unpleasantness ahead, right? What do you need to stockpile to be able to perpetuate the use of those skills over the coming days, weeks, months, years? Doctor stuff? Gauze, tape, gloves, disinfectant, instrumentation, sanitation, batteries, right? Set up. What do you need to build a field clinic? Can you build a field clinic and put it in a small trailer? Now you're the doc at your retreat, in your bug out location, in your community. That's awesome. Talk about building rapport. And the ability to gather intelligence, incredibly important. That is a person of high value in any scenario. So what does Doc need to perpetuate the work that he does? Backstock of that, resilience of that, inventory of that, same thing for you. What do you need? Do you need your reference materials and your books on your shelf and pens and papers and blah, 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 blah? What do you need to perpetuate the work that you do that is also valuable? You don't think that in a traumatizing situation that people are going to need the counsel of a good psychologist? I would agree. I would think that they would. Many people now need those services. And the world has not completely gone to hell in a handbasket yet. So continuing with resilience, basic stuff. Again, prepper classroom level 101 stuff, basic stuff. Where does your water come from? If it comes out of the tap and you don't have any water storage, you need to figure out water storage and alternate means and methods of acquiring water. You live in a desert. It'd be my primary concern, and most preppers fall flat on their face with water procurement, water storage, rainwater catchment. They just assume it's going to be okay. It's not. A loss of electricity to a city of 250,000 people means within 72 hours, the water is likely going to be undrinkable because of the water treatment plants in that city and the water delivery systems within that city. All that requires electrons to work. So if the power goes out because Hezbollah blew up a substation or a Palestinian missile landed on a transfer station or a switch station, or a drone flies into the high line or whatever, or degradation in services because of the global supply chain issues and lack of labor, and the power goes out, within 3 days, if not sooner, your primary source of water is shot. No bueno. So you need multiple sources of water. And that can be as tactical as, what kind of water filter should I get? Prepper classroom. What kind of, or what do I need for water storage? Batteries of tanks, and where? How am I going to purify that and treat that, right? So you need to do your research on that. The resilience aspect, again, is super simple. Look at what you eat and get 3 months of that and put it on a shelf. I don't know your financial situation, and wealth is a relative term that spans the entirety of the socioeconomic strata around the world. You give somebody who's got nothing a $100 bill, they're wealthy. You give somebody who's got millions of dollars in the bank that $100 bill, it has far less impact. Right? So everything's relative. But to the extent that you can, inventory, backstock, stockpile the food that you're already consuming, 3 months at a minimum to 6 months. Then you get into your long-term food storage. This is grains, which are becoming harder and harder to get right now. But you need to backstock grains. And then you get into agriculture. And the math on the grain, people hate hearing the math. They hate it because it's true. It's 750 pounds of grain per person per year. I break that into corn, rice, wheat, and beans. The macronutrients on those are relatively the same. The micronutrients are different. They all have, on average, approximately 1,600 calories per pound. So, at the rate of 750 per year, that works out to 3,277.18 calories per day. If you are engaged in strenuous activity for a military-age male, you require a minimum of 3,200 calories per day to maintain muscle mass while engaged in strenuous activity. And I would submit that SHTF is going to be strenuous. Now, y'all are older. You might not need that many calories. Maybe 1,800 to 2,400 calories. So cut that, you know, stock 60% of 750 pounds. So what's that? 6 times 75, 450 pounds. Per person per year. But I like to prepare for everyone as if they're a military age male, whether it's my toddler or grandma, because that gives me headroom in my inventory. And then you need to focus on production. Now, certain areas of Israel are coming back online from an agricultural productivity standpoint. That is both the fulfillment of prophecy and a blessing of modern technology. How do you grow food in the desert? The short answer to that is I don't know, because I don't live in the desert. But I know that there are people who do. I've watched videos on how people grow in the desert, and there's a difference between watching videos and doing it. But if other people are doing it, you can do it. So I would do the research on that, because at some point, you're going to run out of that backstocked food, and you need to figure out how long you think a conflict is going to be. And then I would recommend, however long you think it's going to be, you double that. Some people prepare for interruptions in goods and services due to inclement weather. If you live in the Northeast, that's a basic understanding that a nor'easter could blow through and wipe out the power, and we're 100% reliant on the wood stove to keep us warm and 100% reliant on the food in the pantry to keep us fed. And that could be a week or a month. In Maine, it's nothing to have half a year's worth of food put up in the pantry. I grew up in upstate New York. That's the way we were raised. That was not preparedness. 6 months of food in the pantry was a way of life. That's not preparedness, right? But however long you think this bad thing's going to happen, I would recommend that you need at a minimum twice that to be able to weather that storm. So, resilience, right? And then I think the issue that you're probably going to run into, may have already run into, is the resistance aspect of this. Living in Israel, it's not impossible to get your hands on firearms and to train with them, but it is difficult. More difficult than it is here in the United States of America, for reasons that we're not going to dive into in this video. But suffice it to say, all Americans within the sound of my voice, if you say you support the Second Amendment, prove it. Stop falling into these false narratives of weapons of war. They are weapons of war. That's why we have them, because the government shall not maintain a monopoly on deadly force. Remember that. But I digress. So for you there in Yisrael, in Beersheba, which was the well of the covenant, which is awesome, super cool. Abraham dug that well. Beersheba. For you there, the ability to be, as they discuss in the book Resistance Operating Concept by Otto C. Fiala, a book I would recommend you get and read. I'm talking specifically to the person who wrote in, but to everybody else as well. Resistance Operating Concept by Otto C. Fiala. You can get it off of Bezos' yacht. You want to be a spiky hedgehog. And yes, that's a ludicrous term, but it works. That means juice versus squeeze. When people are assessing you as a potential target, they see very little meat and a whole lot of spikes. The juice is not worth the squeeze. Now, to affect any type of resistance, as my brother Saul likes to say, you need to be aware of combat geometry and triangles, right? This comes triangles from your shooting sticks or from the way that you hold a rifle to the way you set up a patrol base to assaulters, security, and support by fire to triangles. Right? So I would recommend survival applications and weapons systems here on YouTube, more so on Patreon, for education on combat geometry and what that looks like and why it's important. But I would also think for you, being in that area now, building your network now in Beersheba, in the city, and then also acknowledging that you need a place outside of the city that you can go to. This gets back to people and networks. People matter. Who's the security team? Somebody has to keep night watch if things have gone stupid. And it takes more people than you think. On a small piece of property, you're talking minimum 4 dudes. Minimum 4 well-trained, well-equipped, military-age males who are going to have to eat, who are going to have to poop, who are going to have to sleep, who are going to need downtime and fellowship and all the things that go into creating a tribe. Another excellent book is Creating a Life Together by Diana Leif Christensen. Recommend you check that out as well. And shout out to Pastor Joe Fox of Viking Preparedness for making these book recommendations in the first place. They're excellent books, and I've read them, and they matter. But you need people bought into the concept of tribe, high ideological alignment with those people so that they will get on board with your mission, which brings about, you need to clarify what the mission is. The mission matters. Commander's intent matters. You can't develop an operational order, op board, without it. What are we trying to do? And that gets back to evangelizing with the people that you're going to need on your team. So you need security folks, two up, two down, at a minimum, all the time. The bigger the property, the more people, the more security folks you're going to need. Additionally, who's your reserve and who's your QRF, quick reaction force? So take that four people and triple it. That's 12 people. Now take that food number, that water number, that sanitation issue, the latrine, the septic tank, the outhouse, and triple it at a minimum. See, and it starts to get complicated. That's why when everybody tells me, all these people I hear from with the whole lone wolf concept, well, I'm just going to make it by myself. Maybe for a time you will, but tribe is the way of humans. It has been since the dawn of time. Whether you're a creationist or a evolutionist, it doesn't matter. People have coalesced to form power and exert influence and affect security and productivity and labor since the dawn of time. It works. It's not perfect. It's messy at times, but it works. And so from a resistance standpoint, that gets back to having the people on board that you need to have on board so that you can evangelize. And then if you are in a stage of life where you have more disposable income than others that may be around you, think about how you can equip and empower those people that you need on board with equipment and training so that they can be effective for you and for the tribe as a whole to perform security, to perform basic labor tasks, to plant food, to help with construction of the retreat, whatever it might look like. These are big overarching themes here. It's not little stuff, and it's a natural progression. I started as a lone wolf. It doesn't work. And then it became me and my family against the world, and that worked for a while, and then I realized, that's not going to work. And then I was loosely involved with some militias back in the day, and I realized they just wanted to play dress up. And then I started mutual assistance groups, which is a thing that gets back to your combat geometry and your triangle. Who are the other groups in your area that you should be linking up with, sharing intelligence with, have mutual aid agreements with? Identify them, network with them. Super important. Because they might be over here doing their own thing, but if your homestead gets set on fire, if you can hop on the radio and say, hey, we have an issue over here, we need help, and they can come running, that's not nothing. That's super important. Look at how that's being employed in South Africa right now. Super important, right? Back to this progression. Progressed from mutual assistance groups, which I'm still a part of, and other mags that I still network with, to tribe. Tribe is very important. And tribe for me is defined as people that I would die for and people that would die for me. We watch each other's kids. We eat together, we fellowship together, we worship together, we work together, we do life together. And so, but you can't make a tribe overnight. It sounds like you still have stuff that you need to do where you are to get you squared away. And after you get you squared away, positions of strength, then you can start being concerned about everybody that's around you, bringing them into the fold. Get those next 3 to 5 people or families around you squared away and into the fold, and then evangelize again out from there, 15 to 25 families. That's not nothing. 15 to 25 families is a significant group of people. That's a community. That's a tribe there, if you'll let it. And so focus on your bug out first while having some resilience where you are in the city. then build that resilience, a working pantry of 3 to 6 months worth of food, long-term food storage, and then ultimately production, and then focus on your resistance capabilities. This is skill set, tool set, mindset, combat geometry, and the ability to project influence and force, hard power and soft power. And then within all of that are all the things: convoy operations, logistics, mission planning, communications, medical considerations, especially if your husband is a doc, medical considerations, intel gathering, commo, if I didn't already say commo, transportation. All those things matter, but you need to crawl, walk, run with this, and it sounds like you're just crawling right now. There's always room to grow. There's always room to improve. I have things about what we do that I don't like at all that still require improvement. And we are improving them. We're setting up training opportunities to improve those things. We're purchasing the requisite materials to build. We're training. We're doing stuff together so that we can get better and better and better, sharpening the blade as much as possible that is tribe. But a mediocre rainwater storage system, a gutter that dumps through a hose into an open tank, is better than nothing. So while we should aspire towards perfection, don't let perfection be the enemy of good enough with any of these things. I hope that helped. I'm interested in your comments down below. Appreciate the patrons very much. I appreciate you here on YouTube. If you're new here and you want to stick around, you should go ahead and subscribe. Give this video a thumbs up. And if you're not new here, you know what to do. Share this with somebody you love to help get them on board, help get them better prepared so that we can all weather whatever storm comes in the days ahead. Bless y'all. Shalom.